Australian is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
Hello and a very warm welcome to Weigh In. As we've become accustomed to, it was another busy weekend across the country and Australia. Three-year-olds took centre stage at Tarapa. We had a battle of the Euros in the Caulfield Cup and the Kiwibreds flew the flag high across the Tasman. Michael Guerin, a very warm welcome to you. Great to get into some of the nitty-gritty and excitingly, we start the show with an unbeaten horse.
We do. Good morning to you, Em. Big hi to everybody. Happy Labor Day if you're watching this in New Zealand. All of that racing and so much of the who goes where, particularly through the start and at Tarapa, because the huge question marks out of that and Trentham and some at Pukki this weekend is going to be who gets on the plane to Riccarton. We'll try and answer some of those questions today. And good news, in segment three today, more footage from Ellerslie. Ben, our cameraman, myself and Paul Wilcox did about 8 weeks ago, did a piece on it. Emily, I went there on Friday. I could not believe the development. It's quite remarkable. Stick around for that because I think it's going to put a smile on lots of people's faces, particularly people who might be in Auckland around January the 27th.
Oh, can't wait to hear more about that. For now, though, let's get into our race replays and we start things off with the Group 2 James and Annie Sutton Memorial.
Right there is Fonzie as they swing in. And behind them now, What You Wish For, followed over on the inside by To Catch a Thief, then Beast of Bourbon and Solidify. 300 metres to go. The leader, Crocetti, coming after it now. We've got Lupe Solitario. To Catch a Thief is looking to warm up. It's still Crocetti in front, shooting for five in a row from To Catch a Thief and Lupe Solitario. Snakes alive. That's five in a row for Crocetti. He remains unbeaten and he's done it with his ears pricked. Second over. Photos between Lupe Solitario.
Well, extended the unbeaten record to five from five and found the lead easily, did Crocetti. Warren Kennedy joins us on the phone. Warren, a very warm welcome to you and congratulations for Saturday. No doubt a pretty exciting time because he looks like a very progressive galloper, Crocetti.
Yeah, morning, Emily and Michael. How are you guys doing? Really nice horse. He's really done nothing wrong. Exciting times ahead for Daniel and Danny. What can I say about him? He won a really good race on Saturday.
Warren, I guess the thing that he showed on Saturday, which he has shown us previously, is that he's got that tactical speed to put himself right there in the start prior. He was able to take a sit. He seems like a very versatile horse. Is that how you find him?
Yes, it is. Yeah, he is very versatile. It's crucial he's got that early gate speed. You never know what draw we're going to get in the guinea. So if he does cop an outside draw there, he'll have the speed to get over and find a handy position. But in saying that, he's able to settle really, really quickly behind him as well. So he's really versatile and really easy horse to ride. You can really put him anywhere.
Warren, congratulations on another big day. I know any win at this level was nice, but obviously a bit more emotional on this horse, owned by Daniel Narclay. He was a big part of getting you and your family to come to New Zealand. And I'm sure any time you could win for any owner, it's a big deal when it's a Group 2. But I know this is a little bit more special for you.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's well documented that Daniel was instrumental in getting me over to New Zealand. And just happy to repay him in any way I can, you know, and show the faith he's had in me and produce it on the track. And to win one for him at the Group 2 level, it's just really special. You know, he's a great guy. He does a lot for racing. He's done a lot for myself and my family. So to repay him in any way, it's really special for me.
Warren, everybody is now thinking about the guineas at Riccarton. You go on the $1.60 favourite. Do you think he's a genuine 1,600-metre horse, or do you think it's a case that he may get away with it over 1,600 in this crop? Because he seems to have a very high cruising speed. Can he hold that for a minute and a half?
Yeah, look, that is the crucial talking point here. I feel that he will get the mile on his terms. It could be his limit at the moment as a three-year-old. He'd probably get a bit stronger and do that trip further down the line quite comfortably. But the way he stands right now is I think the mile is probably his limit at the moment. So, the race will tell us if he is a genuine miler. For me, I think he'll get the mile. I think he'll run it. His cruising speed is high, and what helps him is if the pace of the race is pretty hot, he's able to sit off. You know, he's got a good turn of foot, which you saw on Saturday. I was able to hold him up and let them run up to him and then ask him for the effort, and he kept that all the way to the line. So to answer your question, Genuine Mala, it's debatable.
Warren, you had another win on the program, didn't you, in the form of Nest Egg. Let's have a little chat about this horse. You made a decisive mid-race move, and that looked to be the winning of the race. You must be pretty happy with that decision.
Yeah, it's always a great one when those sort of moves pay off. That's why the trainers and owners put you on these horses and allow you to do your thing. You know, they trust that you can read the race and make the right move at the right time. I just got him nice and settled early on, and down the back when the pace started to ease up, I don't know, you won't be able to see the replay of the back stretch, but I had a quick peek out about 100 metres into the back stretch and saw who was in front, and no one was really going to go challenge, and they started to stack it up, and I thought, well, I'll make up this ground without really much effort. And once I got there, the pace really hottened up and he was in a good rhythm, and I made up 4 or 5 lengths without real any effort. So it was a good move and it paid off. And good on Marshy, because he was really confident in the horse as well. It gave me the confidence that he was fit enough to do that sort of thing.
And Warren, he seems like a lovely laid-back horse. He handled that mid-race move, putting him into the race very easily, and he was just full of running, wasn't he? He didn't look to have an overly hard run. He doesn't seem to do things too wrong.
No, really, really easy horse to ride. Settles really quickly, really easily. Once he gets into a rhythm, he's pretty easy to ride. You know, that mid-roof move was... I just pulled him out and allowed him to just extend his stride. You know, I didn't really ask him for any effort to get up there. And once he got up there, he got into a good rhythm again, and he gave me a good kick in the straight as well, and he ran to the line. So it was a really sort of comfortable win for him. I know that's what Marshy wanted, because he's going to go the 2 miles later on. But all things looking good for that, he's pretty fit. He'd done that really easily, so he'll come out of that run with improvement.
Warren, you find yourself in a place you probably didn't think you would be 18 months ago, at the head of the New Zealand Jockeys Premiership. Last week you were at Ashburton, you also went to Whangatui. Are you going to actively chase the premiership, or like most of our top jockeys, is it a case of getting through the black type summer, seeing where you are, and then making your choices for that last 3 or 4 months of the season?
Yeah, I think that's more of the safer option. You know, you don't want to... I didn't see myself being in front at this moment. Paint a point, bit of a target on your back. That's not where you want to be, trying to fight to hold your position. But look, we're in the lead. I'm going to press forward and travel a little bit. We'll see where we are through the summer, because those are the major races. You want to be around for that track work and getting those horses ready for those races. You want to be more focused on them. But once the summer ends and we're still in contention, we'll give it a good push for the end and see where we end up.
Warren, you've been to plenty of tracks in the last week. One track you haven't been to, I believe you may be heading to this week for the first time because you're suspended, Ellerslie.
Yep.
I'm sure you're looking forward to seeing Ellerslie. I know everybody's told you it's going to be great to ride there. I believe there could be a trip into central Auckland at some stage to check out headquarters.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll take a trip down there this week. Nice to see. I've been watching the videos you guys have been posting up about it. It's progress. It's looking really good. Didn't want to go too early because with all the construction and not everything laid out properly, it's pretty pointless, you know. But once the track's all sorted out, and that we'll see what the end result is, and we'll have a good look and walk around and really looking forward to it. Here it's the hub of New Zealand racing. Haven't been able to experience it yet. Looking forward to it. And, yeah, it looks like a nice track from the videos I've seen, and looks like a track that'll suit me.
Warren, based on what you've been doing over the past couple of seasons, no doubt there'll be some big victories at Ellerslie as well. Thank you so much for your time this morning, and well done on another massive weekend.
Cheers from your lips to God's ears. Emily, thanks very much. Thanks for having me on the show, guys. Really appreciate it, and really enjoy your show.
Well, thank you, Warren. He's in crazy form. He's leading the premiership, which is all bizarre when you think none of us had heard of Warren Kennedy about 18 months ago. Let's go through a few things here, Em. Crocetti is absolutely not bred to get 1600. Now, close relation to Killarney, who did get 1600 as an older horse, you go back through that Grace Hill family, there's no real 1600 metre form, very fast family. I think he might get away with it in this crop because maybe two or three of the best other horses, and that's no disrespect to Lantern Way, but Tokyo Tycoon won't be there. Lupo Solitario's not going to the Guineas. So I think he might get away with it, but you can hear in Warren's voice there, it might be a stretch.
But I think often within their own age, they can do it, can't they? Three-year-olds meeting three-year-olds, and we might never see them over the mile again, but so often they can get away with it at their own age. And as you said, with the race falling away a touch, it sort of sets up really nicely. He's got a bit of brilliance about him, hasn't he? And I think that'll take him a long way.
I think one of the crucial factors is he jumped and then came back to Warren.
Yeah.
And Warren's a senior rider, so he's not going to get him too revved up. Just looking at this list, I'll go through it quickly for you. Troy Brand is in the South Island. Obviously, he's going to race in the 2000 Guineas. Lisa Ladd has already told us. Lantern Way will head there. Spoke to Richo yesterday. To Catch a Thief is booked on the plane after a third on Saturday. That's its, believe it or not, seventh third in a row. Talisker won yesterday at Ashburton in quite an easy field, but look, really is beautifully placed in the South Island, lights Rickerton, lots of ticks. Danjuro we'll see shortly. Geriatrics, now this is interesting, it goes to the 65 mile at Pukekohe on Saturday. If it performs well, it will head to Rickerton. Luberon obviously is going to go to the 1000 Guineas and we'll see Bozo shortly. Solidify was good the other day, ran on late, still a bit clunky Emily in some of its work. It's a horse with a lot to learn. And Monday Melody for Andrew and Lance, they said, look, it was only okay, but it wasn't an easy day to be storming down the outside and coming from off the speed. They'll wait to see how he settles through the next couple of days and then they'll decide whether he joins potentially Geriatrics on the plane. So a lot of trainers thrilled there's a plane. They can make their decisions later. Most of them are going to go, but the two big names who aren't, Lupo Solitario and Tokyo Tycoon, obviously both deemed set for the now $1.5 million Karaga Millions three-year-old, sponsored by the TAB.
Next race that we look at is another stakes race from Tarapa, and it is the Group 3 Swayness Stakes over the 1,200 metres, and it provided a win for Johnny Johnny.
Was New York Jazz, and with it also Fontaine at the 300. Johnny Johnny for the leader just from Sassy Merlot. Two lengths away, beep out of the pack, followed by Is That So Tight Lane. It's still Johnny Johnny at the 100 metres from Sassy Merlot. Beep is coming after them, and so is Tight Lane out wide. Johnny needs the post. Johnny Johnny just in front. Keep going. Oh, I think he just got this close. Man, it's close. Johnny Johnny in a photo with a lunging beep, Habana, and out wide, Tight Line, and right with them, Sassy.
Don't know how you can't sort of love Johnny Johnny. He's just got a way about him. He gets out in front, he burns along. In this race, he was burnt the candle at both ends. He was really tough getting this win. And that record, Michael, 10-time winner in 17 starts. He's just a warhorse, isn't he? And a first stakes win, a first black type success for Jim Chung, who did a marvellous job riding.
And the Carters are doing a great job with the horse. They're giving him enough gaps between his races to let him refill his energy tank. This is a remarkable win, and if you go through the sectionals, you'll see why. They went 19.52 for 1,200. That's about standard for a very good horse. But that's not the amazing part. They came home in 35.19. Now, that's slow for this grade. The reason? They went the first 600 from a standing start in 34.33. Well, that's just outrageous. That's as quick as I can remember them going in a major race and the leader still winning. So Beep actually was a little bit involved in that burn. It was from an inside draw. So it's done a good job too. But most of the others who were there at the finish were back in the field. Habana was running on well. Rio Dini was running on well out wide. But 34.33 is lightning quick from a standing start. That's really fast. So that shows that Johnny Johnny can be a factor in races like the Railway, maybe not so much the Telegraph down the dog leg, because when you go through the Railway last year, he was beaten by a lot of great horses, Imperators and Babylon Berlin and those type of horses. A lot of those horses aren't going to be in the Railway this year. And the other thing is, even that's a Group 3, he'll get 1 kilo penalty at the set weights and penalties. He'll only be carrying 56. He's been carrying a lot bigger weights recently against probably half the railway field. Now, the most obvious horse who will be in the railway is Dragon Leap. He'll be heading there. But when you think about the New Zealand sprinters, and Imperatrice is so good, she won't be coming back for a railway, Emily. So there's probably a little bit of a gap with Levante retired now, and you know, the Legatos of the world overdoing their thing in Australia, that it might not be the strongest railway ever, and Johnny may not win it. But on what we saw, he's going to be a real factor. Sassy Merlot was excellent because she was on the speed and that incredibly fast lead time. And Habana and Rio Dini, I think once they both get to the mile in, they're going to be really big factors in races like the Captain Cook or the Rich Hill.
It's a nice segue, isn't there, as well, because Johnny was a graduate of the 2019 Ready to Run sale. He made just $12,500, a value purchase, and obviously the Ready to Run sales are fast approaching, aren't they?
Yeah, and they had the breezes last Monday and Tuesday, so well done to Bart Cowan from Tarapa, of course, and the team at NZB. It's a massive job, the breezes, and to all the jockeys involved, because some were supposed to be at Ashburton and it got delayed, and it got really messy, and a lot of people have to work really hard to make that happen. It's a great sale. We know that Golden 60, Lucky Swain S, Mr. Brightside, Sharp and Smart have all gone through the sale. So those breezes are up on NZB, and if you have a spare hour or two, Em, the one thing I would say is it's hard to watch one or two breezes. It's like potato chips. Once you open the bag, you tend to sit down and be watching.
Once you pop, you can't stop.
About 300 horses. So it's, the breezes, and the sale is, I think, the 17th and 18th out of Karaka.
The Group 3 Thompson Handicap at Trentham is where we get to next. It was won by This Is Dramatic, an early market dominated by Lisa Latta.
One. Bully Boy down on the inside is the leader here from Flower of Bonica. This Is Dramatic, desperate to get out. Kelly Coe is joining these over on the outside with a pretty good run. And then wider out is Mazzolino. This Is Dramatic on the inside. Flower of Bonica. Mazzolino over on the outside trying to get to them. Kelly Coe late. This Is Dramatic. This Is Dramatic in front and down to the line. This Is Dramatic will get it. Mazzolino second, a line up third. One bold cat, Flower of Bonica. Crossroads right.
Well, Bilardo Boy was right in the market as well, but it was the time for This Is Dramatic to shine. Lisa's fifth Thompson Handicap win, Lisa Latta, that is. Got a trivia question for you, Michael. Who was Lisa's last win in the Thompson Handicap?
He's a doozy, last year.
Oh, nailed it. Thought I might get you there. Nope.
She's very good at putting horses in the right race at the right weight, and what she's done here is not only got into this race with the right weight, as Tina Komayagi gets a double for the day, but she's going to get into the Copeland's Mile with the right weight. So we've got the market for that for you now. See, when you look at the Copeland's Mile, it's business time, and This Is Dramatic head the market. But they'll probably, as best I can sort of work it out, only get 53 kilos each, because there's enough horses like Lightning Jack, who's going to be in the market, who is obviously a boy. They are female horses, so they get a discount at the weights anyway. And if he gets the 60 top weight, well, they're about 10 rating points behind him. This Is Dramatic will get 4 or 5 points for the weekend or something like that. So all of a sudden, by the time you put those rating 91, 92 horses, and there's a few there who are higher rated who I don't think will turn up, that puts them on 60. These other horses are 4 or 5 kilos below. Then they get the mare's allowance in. She's going to get into this race, I think, with 53 kilos. And so will it's business time. So beautifully trained, loves Rickerton, won a feature two-year-old race there, won the War Decree last weekend there. So, by the way, I got those dates wrong for the sales, the ready-to-run sales at Karaka, 20th and 21st of November. So hard on the back of Cup Week coming out of Christchurch, 20th and 21st if you want to buy Golden 60.
Great stuff if you want to buy Golden 60. If you'd be lucky enough to buy Golden 60, geez, that's what Michael's hoping he's going to buy at the Ready to Run sales. Let's get to the Staphnos Classic at Trentham. And this one was won by Blackwood Star, who minded its own business out the back.
Raise another effort on the inside, Anders, and Semba Magico tracks through on him. Raced up, hit the front, Semba Magico from Hit the Road Jack. Then You Are a Star starting to come home, and Blackwood Star and In My Shadow starting to push through, and LJ is out wide. wider. Simba Magico, you are a star, and Blackwood Star on the inside, finishing really hard. Blackwood Star got to the lead, and Blackwood Star beats You Are a Star. Simba Magico and My Shadow hit the road, Jack. What a great horse race. Then LJ behind them when he rose.
Well, Blackwood Star was slow out from the soft draw, but actually perhaps proved to be the winning of the race because it was out of all the carnage that was going on up front. We had numerous different leaders. The race changed complexion so many times. It became a real staying test, and Blackwood Star was able to blouse over the top of them. With regards to the beaten horses, You're a Star, Strong Late, and LJ just got going when the race was over.
Going to be a really strong New Zealand Cup trial. Spoke to Dan O'Leary. He said, we want to go to the New Zealand Cup. The only issue is Blackwood Star, I think, was like a rating 67 going into this race. It's going to get a stack of points. It's beaten the Auckland Cup winner of last year, so it will get into the race, you would think. It's actually raced twice over 2 miles before in Road to the Jericho races. So it's been around a bit, and its mother raced over 2 miles. So it will stay, clearly, and they're hoping to get into this New Zealand Cup field with, when you look at Nest Egg, LJ, You Are a Stars, obviously an Auckland Cup winner, I think it's going to have a bit more depth to it, maybe opinion type horse, than some New Zealand Cups. Sometimes you go to New Zealand Cup Day and you're like, really? But I think it's going to be a pretty good New Zealand Cup, and this horse will add to that because it's a proper 2 mile horse.
Yeah, love the run of You're a Star in that second spot. Next up is the Happy Hire 3-year-old set, Weights and Penalties. This was taken out by Bozo.
And then we've got Chantilly's. Bozo's presented in the middle. Dangero's made a lot of ground and quickly here. Stipulated the leader to the 300 metres. Bozo comes after it. Enduro comes after the two. Pignon fights on in the middle, and Chantilly's is looking to run at them, but Bozo's raced up, hit the lead now. Dangero's trying to gun her down. Bozo diligent though, really giving. Dangero tries hard, then Chantilly's, but Bozo, a beauty, grabs the first of the day. Dangero second, third. Chantilly stipulator behind them, Pignon up the ante-bow.
Well, Bozo's by sire of the moment, Sotono Aladdin, never finished out of the money in its career to date, and I thought it was really strong to the line, actually, and been knocking on the door to get a win like this, Michael, and this will certainly be the confidence boost that it needs.
Well, on that, 1600 at Ricken's going to be no concerns, as you would expect by Sotono Aladdin. Great to see Tina Komanyagi up riding at Trentham. When someone like Kevin Myers and Lisa Latter say, we want you to come north to ride, it's fantastic.
And she's right, and we spoke about the premiership with Warren, and she's right there in the top five.
Yeah, top five, doing a great job. So look, this horse clearly can win what's a very open 1,000 guineas. Just on the 1,000 guineas, horses like Molly Bloom and Luberon are going to head to Pukekohe this week for the soliloquy, so that'll be a moving day for this crop. Go down the list, and here's a horse called Star of Justice, who this last is, week...
Stop it.
Last
stop,
week...
Stop.
It won, here it is. I'll take over here. So it won the Barnswood Farms at Ashburton. And for those who don't know, Star of Justice is part owned by Emily Bolson, because her husband, a guy called Opie Bolson, bought her a share in a racehorse for her birthday. And
Michael, let's enjoy the replay.
No, and bizarrely, you've won a Group 3. Which must have been a nice buzz. And I own a share in the horse who ran third. So once again, you have outshone me, Emily. Look, that's... Oh, no.
I knew this
was coming.
What do I
get getting beheaded on this show?
I just love it when I can get one over you, Michael. And it's that was a great... We have some great content creators in our team.
This should be a HR issue. I'm a person too, you know. I've got feelings.
I think you're tough enough to handle it.
What was it like? First of all, winning a Group 3, but knowing that, bizarrely, you're going to be on track presenting on 1,000 Guineas Day, and you've got a winning chance in the race.
I just can't believe that I own a bit of tail of a horse that's a stakes winner for a start.
Have you owned a stakes winner before?
I've never owned a stakes. I'm lucky if I've owned a winner, let alone a stakes winner. And I've got so much backtracking to do, because if you know me, you know how much I grumbled and groaned when I got this birthday present of what a waste of money it is, and et cetera, et cetera. And here I am eating my words, because I've got a top three chance in a 1,000 guineas. So Wow, it's super cool. And she's done what she needs to do. She's won a black type race, so the rest is just sit back and enjoy the day.
The only thing it made me think was that if you were a better wife, Opie would have bought you a share in Imperatrice. But never mind. I mean, that's the bacon butties you taught your
she
husband
might
with.
She might be a Imperatrice. We don't know.
That's what happens when you eat in front of your husband when he's starving because he's a jockey. Just on that race, actually, I had a horse who was third. It's going to go to the 1,000 guineas as well. Very varied.
You've dropped that in a couple of times.
I've got to keep dropping it in too. And very varied 1,000 guineas market because Luberon is going to Pukekohe this week and it's going to have a new rider. Celine Gaudry, this is a great story. Superstar apprentice in Victoria is coming across Henry Plumtree, from Cambridge Stud, booked her to come across. So Celine is coming to Pukekohe. She'll bring a lot of Australian and Victorian eyeballs with her. She's got to ride Luberon because Warren is suspended. And spoke to her last week. She's only got one vacant race this week, the Open 1200. She has rides in every other race. And she said, I'm really looking forward to getting there. And because it's so hard to get rides on a big Saturday like Cox Plate Day, she said, if it goes well, I'm really open to coming back for other carnival days. So we have this shortage of jockeys at the moment with so many suspended. Opie's going to Aussie this week, obviously, for Imperatrice. Warren Kennedy's out, Nabba's out this week. Ryan Elliott, Cozzy Asano, and Jasmine and Tegan are all out to at least Friday. And then there's ones who are injured. Alan Nicholas, unfortunately, got injured last week. Our thoughts are with you, Alan. She's in a cast again. Tamai Tairoa, Donovan Cooper, Noka Haley. We've got a lot of people on the sidelines. And you can see how someone like Celine coming across is going to add some real depth and some positivity to this meeting. So I would suggest if you're a trainer out there, make overtures about maybe getting her to Riccarton for some of these days because we do have big fields down there and a few gaps. But it'd be great to have her here on Saturday, and she said she's really looking forward to being part of it and maybe even part of our New Zealand summer.
Well, New Zealand Cup week is fast approaching, and Riccarton's chief executive Tim Mills was with us and gave us his thoughts of the upcoming carnival.
Tim, we're standing on the historical side of the old Grand National stand, but quite clearly it's not with us anymore.
No, after the earthquakes and a prolonged insurance battle and a bizarrely long application to get a building consent, the demolition's taken place. I always said I'd have a tear in my eye. I came down with Alan Edge the first day the big high-reach demolition equipment started pulling her down, and I damn near did. You know, it was sad in the sense that it acknowledged the passing of a bygone era of how people participated in racing. But look, the reality is, as we're seeing with a lot of historic buildings, the cost to repair and strengthen is excessive. There was no point the club going broke. The stand was built for its purpose of being. It wasn't there to be the reason for its demise. So look, sadly it's down, but we are now looking with huge excitement as to the benefits that the site can provide.
Let's talk about where we stand now and what it will provide, because from what I've seen graphically, I can't wait to see it on race day because it looks really exciting.
Look, it does, Greg. We're sitting at the level of the old Red Promenade. We've built forward with a grassed hill in front of what was the Red Promenade, and we've gone back 10 metres. So we've got basically about 38 metres by about 70 metres long of a flat pavilion terrace that for Cup Week we're going to build with tents. We've taken the opportunity, whilst the stand was demolished, to completely redo all our infrastructure right from the main road. That's the potable water, the irrigation water, the sewerage, data, power and everything else. So we've basically taken the opportunity to completely future-proof the core infrastructure for the race course for the next probably 100 years. What we've come up with is a means of, if you like, just plugging in. So these tents will just plug in. So if we do in time put something permanent on this site, it will all be able to be connected into that infrastructure as well. Now on the other side of the pavilion, with a drop of about a metre and a half or thereabouts, we've got a big flat area. We're going to have the nation bar, we're going to have toilets, we're going to have totes, we're going to have food court, and basically people, the general public, for want of a description, will be able to purchase food and beverage from the back. They'll be able to flow around the front. So down in front of us here, we're going to have umbrellas, places where people can sit, just roll a blanket out, you know, enjoy the day on the grass.
And all importantly, no vehicles, as in the past has been the case.
Look, there's going to be vehicles just at the far end. We've got some pre-sold car parks there. And then on the other side of that hedge is the young people's area where we've got the band playing, and there'll be thousands of young people in there. We've got some new shade infrastructure coming in. We've been able to pull the whole course tighter. And I think that's going to be a huge benefit. So instead of having this massive, disused sort of monolith sitting there dominating the area, we're going to have activity, we're going to have atmosphere, we're going to have people. It's going to be sensational.
Tell me about the tickets and people watching this thinking, right, I need to be part of this. What is available and where's the best place to go?
Well, look, obviously the best to make your decision whether you want to be in the members area, which is going to be very similar to the past, though we have the Guineas Terrace we've created as a sort of general members owners area, brought all the corporate area onto the new hill. Basically the GA option or the members option. We're doing pre-releases at discounted prices, so keep an eye on our website and just get in and buy your ticket, because look, last year we got the 15,000 max. We sold out. I think on the morning we sold one to Sam Kane, so we had 15,001. It will sell out this year, and we got absolutely no doubt that'll happen. So look, get in, get your ticket now, because that's the only message I can really send.
Right you are, who you mailed into the straight from Valiant King. West Wind blows, break up. They were followed by Bois d'Argent without a fight, and Gold Tripper running on. West Wind blows at the 200 without a fight, runs on, lays in on top of Gold Trip. West Wind blows 100 to go without a fight, coming at it without a fight. West Wind blows for Hinch and Unison without a fight.
So sick before this race. You know, my husband says if you have a bad dream, you say it out loud, and if you have a good dream, you don't say it. And I only told him part of my good dream. My good dream was we drew barrier 7, and then we drew barrier 7, but the other part of my dream was that we f***ing won. That was my dream on Wednesday night, or Tuesday night. Oh, sorry, I cussed.
Just had a beep in there.
If there was a prize for interview of the weekend, Elise Zara, Mark Zara's wife, she takes it, hands down. It's hers. She's off into
that
the sunset.
That might be you on Saturday at the Monocado, because you're going to the Valley, aren't you?
I'm at the Valley on Saturday.
Do not swear.
I won't be leaving the Seven hosting set. I'll be locked in there.
I love that emotion. It's pretty cool. And ironic when you know how cool Mark Zara is. Like, Mark is such a cool big race customer. Gee, there was a lot of moving parts to that. Obviously, former stable mates running first and second. Beautiful ride on all of the first three. Zara's just a genius in big runs, big races. I thought the second horse was outstanding.
Yeah, another really gallant run by it, wasn't it?
And then question marks around Gold Trip. Does he go to a Cox Plate? And that might be affected by whether it rains in Melbourne this week.
I think he still ran super well. He was held up momentarily. He had the big weight to carry, defying sort of history, you could say. I think he's run another really
solid.
Yeah,
I thought he was great. I mean, the question mark's not about his performance, about what he does next.
Yeah.
Like, does he go for the treble, which he tried last year? Does he go straight to the Melbourne Cup? Who rides him in the Melbourne Cup? Does Mark get back on? What about the winner? Because Mark was of the opinion over the Queensland Winter Carnival he wasn't a two-mile horse because he failed in the Melbourne Cup last year. A year stronger, do you think he's a factor, or do you think he's more of a 2,400-metre horse?
God, it's really hard to say, isn't it? I guess connections are just going to be led by what Mark said after the Caulfield Cup. He certainly got to the line over the 2-4 fine, but do you risk it again? And what do you got to lose? It's probably relatively at the end of the preparation anyway. Why not have another throw at the stumps?
The other thing too is, you know, this race is like the old Tancred, which are like $1.5 million, or it's hard to work out what they're worth in Sydney these days because they keep going up all the time. But you could say, well, if we stick to 2,400 or 2,000, he's so many options for the horse. If you go to the Melbourne Cup and you fail, then you have to go straight to the paddock. In fact, you go to the Melbourne Cup, you go straight to the paddock, more or less. Really interested to see Solcombe and Francisco Guardi so high in the market there. With the Europeans so dominant, and I know they're ex-Europeans, but it's just really hard to factor in that on what they did the other day, forget the start for Solcombe, but just on his performance, that he's going to beat Vauban, that he's going to beat Gold Trip. that he's maybe going to beat without a fight. And
he can't do. He can't miss the start like he did and be competitive at all. I mean, that's the worst he's probably been, isn't it?
Such a hard way to race. I mean, just chasing all the time. So I think the Melbourne Cup market's fascinating every year because every year some horse will win a Bart Cummings or something and it gets into $5. But as we see again and again and again, it's just irrelevant the form to the Europeans get here. Nothing we do here matters until the best Europeans turn up because the next level of Europeans, Emily, are too good for ours.
Gold Trip is a horse that absolutely loves racing. You can see that from what he does. He was competitive in a Cox Plate last year. Do they potentially think of doing the three again?
I think it depends if there's any rain this week. He would be more competitive with Sting out of the track. I think the big improver is going to be Romantic Warrior. He was disappointing, but maybe blew out fresh up, but everything he's done in track work since and talking to James, they think he's going to improve enormously. It's a good Cox Plate. Mm. It's not a Winks Cox Plate, but it's a really balanced Cox Plate, and I think maybe the final market might come down to barrier draws. Just getting to number 18 there, Light Infantry Man, he is out, so he leaves the race. And I think Zach Purton was going to ride him. I think he now goes across to Fangirl. So it'll be a bit of moving around this week with the barrier draws and all that sort of stuff and track conditions. But I'll be very surprised if Romantic Warrior doesn't start a pretty tight favourite, particularly with the World Pool. So the World Pool is this big pool run through Hong Kong. And obviously they're going to be jumping on Romantic Warrior.
Yeah, lots of pieces to fall into place as we build into the Cox Plate on Saturday. Let's move along to the undercard at Caulfield, and it was dominated by Kiwi breds, including Cur Volant, who took out the 1,000 Guineas Prelude.
Volant sidled up on the outside and took the front. 200 metres to go. A length and a quarter, Zorayan, Inhibitions and Moesha. Coeur Volant, a length, Zorayan, Inhibitions, Vivier late. Coeur Volant, 50 metres to go. This has been a terrific ride. And Coeur Volant wins it. Second, Vivier or Zorayan, then Moesha, Inhibitions from Bossy Nick. Next to Zula. From a
back-to-back stakes victories bred by the Fell family at Fairdale Stud. A $90,000 Prima Park purchase, Michael, and it was a lovely effort by this horse who looks to have upside and no doubt will handle the step up to the mile. Zurian in behind also, really brave performance by it too.
It trapped wide the entire race, Zurian. I'm sure it's going to press forward to the 1,000 Guineas. That's what they sent her there to win. I thought she was really good. Has had no luck in two runs, but just Coeur Volant. Paul Moroney, I know Mike does some of the work at the sales, but Paul and Catherine, man, they've got an eye for a horse. Like, when you buy these ones for $90,000 and then 6 months later, Paul will be up in Europe buying horses at Deauville or the Ascot sales or whatever sale he can get to. He's just, you know, so good at finding the right type of horses. We're going to see another one on later in Buffalo River. But no reason to think it can't win this. Admittedly, it's a very open 1,000 Guineas market with no definitive favourite. Aprilia also there for Andrew Forsman, so we could have two New Zealand reps. I'm surprised. So Ryan,
yeah, didn't
is
close
it $26?
Yeah, I based off that run, but maybe some value to be had there.
And it's obviously later this year, the 1,000 Guineas, so the 1,000 Guineas used to be run middle of last week, but yeah, it's been bumped out of touch, which hasn't been popular
November
for everybody.
It is now,
but,
yeah.
But, yeah, I think it's going to work for the New Zealand horses, particularly Zorayan, able to get over there a bit later. But, yeah, well done to Paul and to everybody involved at Ballymore because they just consistently find these horses who don't seem to cost a lot of money.
The Tristark was also dominated by New Zealand bred and Rota Arataki galloped from start to finish to take out success.
Double dancer. Rota Arataki went for home at the 250. A length in front of Skewiff, who possessed with a run-up on the inside. Rota Arataki about three-quarters to Skewiff, who has to breathe in, then waltz on by and cool die late. Rota Arataki, 50 metres to go, packing too many punches and one. Rota Arataki has won it from Shovel Dancer, Cool Dye, Madame Pomery, then waltz on by.
Led from start to finish did Rota to Arataki, a five-year-old mare heading towards the Group 1 Empire Rose, a daughter of Rota, who of course stands at Highview Stud, Michael.
Yeah, and he's got five going through the Ready to Runs next month on the 20th and 21st. So, yep, doing a good job, Rota. He can actually leave a really good-looking horse, and he stands really cheaply, so well done to Highview. It's a nice little boost for them heading into the back end of breeding season. Skewith, I thought, didn't get a gap, but then looking above, it was well enough beaten. What did Opie say?
Yeah, I think the room was there if needed up the rail. When you looked at the head-on, there was clearly enough room for her to go through. 6 weeks between runs was sort of what they were thinking with regards to her, and they were happy to just reassess based off how she pulled up.
Yeah, I suppose she is. The Golden Eagle might be a bridge too far, but they do have the Empire Rose as maybe potentially another race for her. Just on the Golden Eagle, obviously Legato is heading there. Amelia's Jewel, they are saying they're going there after last start's little disaster. And Obama Burumai has turned up in Sydney. It's been working at Canterbury. So Obama Burumai's there, and he's a very good horse. And then there's, you know, lots of depth to the race. But yes, at this stage, we have a New Zealand-trained favourite. Prowess is on that page, but not heading there. Prowess goes to the Valley for the Crystal Mile this Saturday. Galloped beautifully in between races at Karapa on Saturday.
The Munga is the next race that we look at from Caulfield. This was taken out by Buffalo River. Buffalo River, of course, is defying his age. He's bounced right back into form. Three stakes victories to the name. It was an effort by Celine Gaudry, who's got a great affinity with Buffalo River. Mike Moroney, who had a wonderful day on Saturday. And I guess worth a chat around Mr. Meister as well, who no doubt, Michael, looking for further.
Yeah, he's looking for further, and I think looking for Flemington. I think he enjoys the big track at Flemington. So up to the mile, I think he'll be a different horse. Will be Mr. Maestro. This horse is just an old warrior, just keeps turning up. And yep, there's Celine, who we'll see going in an opposite direction at Pukekohe this week. So again, magical day for Team Moroney to have two winners on Caulfield Cup Day and two good stakes winners that, as I said, they just find them. When you go to the sales and you see how much time Paul spends around horses, he's not one of those excitable people. He's methodical about everything he does. At any sale you go to all around the world, and days like Saturday pay off.
They sure do. Let's take you up to Sydney now, because Palmetto was successful taking out the $1 million Five Diamond Prelude. Big well done to the White Robe Lodge team, the progeny of Ghibellines. Started its career with Sally Mackay, Michael, and it was a Kiwi-bred Quinella, of course, because we had Detonator Jack in second spot. But Cathy O'Hara post-race, she said he just wanted to win, needed to find a bit extra, and he did. He stuck the head out where it mattered.
Yeah, it won the Southland Guineas, won the Dunedin Guineas. It's also won the $500,000 at the Coast at Gosford back in May. So it's won over $1 million since joining Sarge in Sydney, and now has the $2 million Five Diamonds coming up in a couple of weeks on November the 11th. So well done to the team in the South, not only for Ghibellines, who of course is standing at White Robe Lodge, but some of the owners stayed in the horse. Really cool story.
I understand there was a few hangovers at Randwick due to an All Black test in the morning. I think there was a few of them were feeling a bit seedy, but no doubt Palmetto brought them right.
Well, when you live in the South Island, $1 million stakes just seem like something that happens to other people. And congratulations to them. And I'm sure they've all booked to go back for the $2 million race on November the 11th. So, yeah, it's a great story and great segue for people who have horses in the South Island. When agents come saying, look, we might want to buy your horse, to say, yeah, OK, well, these are legitimate horses. These can travel overseas and win big races and make you a lot of money, and they probably aren't that expensive. So I think it's a wonderful story, and congratulations to the Palmetto team.
Peace Officer and King of the Castle were also Kiwi-bred winners on the card at Randwick. King of the Castle was one that we wanted to highlight because trained by Joe Pride, Everest-winning trainer, qualified now for the $3 million Big Dance, the first two home, get into that on Melbourne Cup Day at Randwick. There's a cool story here, which I didn't even realise, Michael. Joe Pride, he actually spent a decade living in Dunedin when he was a youngster, and he said, King of the Castle, he comes from the deep south as well, and he's got a bit of a man crush on this horse, and he's bred by Raveston Stud, started with Kelvin Tyler, and Joe, he just really respects this horse and the time he spent in the South, and he feels he's got a bit of affinity with him.
I didn't know that either. So Joe Pride spent a decade in Dunedin.
That's what I've read, yes. Yep.
I'm not saying you're lying. I'm sure you're telling the truth, but man.
Who knew, right?
Who did know? Yeah.
Can we claim him as a Kiwi, Everest-winning Kiwi trainer?
So now he's beaten another Kiwi, and I wish I win in the Everest. And this horse finds a line hard. And, gee, it's exciting if you own horses like this and you get to go to, what did you say, $3 million for the big
dance? $3 million big dance, first two home qualify for the big dance on Melbourne Cup Day.
Sometimes I look at the stakes in Sydney and races just seem to be coming out of nowhere and they're worth so much money. I can't work out how it all works, but It's nice if you're involved.
It is. Million-dollar race every 4 days, apparently, across the Tasman. Let's get you to a break. On the back of that, we bring you all the news from the tracks. So every day or night, I leave my heart on the floor. It doesn't feel right. I need someone in your
local ear. Now Luma, King of Steel, is pulled towards the outside. A furlong and a half to go. Horizon d'Or and Via Sistina are locked together. Behind these Royal Rhyme, King of Steel, Point Lonsdale rallying. It's Via Sistina, the fair, who takes it up for Oisin Murphy. King of Steel down the outside for Frankie Dettori with half a length to find. 100 yards to go. King of Steel on the outside of Via Sistina. A certain inevitability about Frankie Dettori and King of Steel winning the Champion Stakes. I'm a poor man who needs some money. I'm a poor man who needs a job.
I want money to buy cigarettes. My Twitter feed was just awash of all things Frankie after Champions Day. In true Frankie style, he went out in magnificent fashion with a number of wins at Ascot, and that flying dismount one final time in the UK.
I'm not sure he's the best jockey in the world. I think most people think that's Ryan Moore, but he's the most important jockey in the world. He brings the most eyeballs, he brings the most different audience. Frankie is now supposedly retiring from English racing and heading to America to live. Just on Frankie, he was offered a chance to come to Ellerslie for Karaka Million Day. That won't be happening because there was an appearance fee and it was too much to make it worth everybody's while. But he's heading to America. If Frankie Dettori is still healthy and doesn't ride at Royal Ascot next year, I'll give up drinking until he does ride there again.
Oh, I'm going to get in touch
seriously
with Frankie.
When I went to Ascot this year,
I
went to Ascot last year and I was talking to people who knows, people who were in the jockey's room, and they were like, of course Frankie's not retiring.
I know you say that.
It's a great story,
but
it wasn't true.
Not a great story, but it's an awesome way to celebrate a magnificent career.
I totally agree. Frankie's
awesome. Get around it, Michael. Get off the negative buzz. Get around it.
It's most important to tell punters the truth. That's the most important thing in racing. Fairy tales are for books. He was never going to retire, and everybody in the jockey's room knew he wasn't retiring, and then we pretended he was, and I'll be staggered if he's not at Royal Ascot next year. I'll give up drinking until he appears here again if he doesn't turn up at Royal Ascot next year.
I'm just going to mute you in a minute because we've got to get to Ellerslie because we've got an update, a track update. Let's stick to our own news and find out more from Paul Wilcox.
Beautiful, brother. We're opening the gates for Ellerslie. Wilco, when you sit here, it's like a green carpet. It looks magnificent. Did the soil samples and the core testing suggest it's magnificent underneath?
Absolutely, and probably surprised us a little bit, Michael. Far deeper than what we expected, particularly here where it's only had just over 8 weeks of growth. And to have those roots down at 250 millimetres, that blew us away and gave us a lot of confidence that what we're doing is the right thing. And probably relaxed a lot of people. Our goal is crack a million and it's still on.
What's the return to racing protocols Ellerslie has to go through to get us back racing, first of all, in early January?
Praying for more days like this, a lot of sun, rain, but their main priority is fertilising, putting the fertiliser on, obviously water if it's needed, and then mowing. So that's going to make the sward of the grass get nice and thick and be prepared and ready, as you can see here, for horses to run over. And then we've got the protocol of late November where horses come for gallops, and that's going to be about 20 horses where we just can try out the various stages of the track. Then that gets ticked off by the jockeys, then we'll go into jump outs, which is a little bit more sophisticated, let's say, and then we'll move into trials. And if those processes get ticked off, then all steam ahead for Karaka Million. But we'll know before that, right? Once we've had the first horses over here, horses could come over it now and it wouldn't be a problem.
Paul, as we turn around and look down the Ellerslie Strait, which has been...
It's been mowed as we speak.
Been relatively unused for quite a while.
Watch out, Trish.
Is there anything which jockeys or punters or trainers would feel different about this racetrack now compared to what it was 2 years ago?
Number one is coming into the home straight here, the home bend. You can see the camber's been changed. So we're at about a 4% camber now. Then
is that more or less?
More. Okay. So we were probably one.
Because there was an issue, some horses came to Ellerslie, they big open space, they come around the bend and they get a bit lost. Yeah, is that to
everyone's
help
got
with
issues,
that?
But yeah, exactly. Yeah. But yeah. No, it just makes it fairer, right? And then the same going around Hospital Bend, we've got the same change in camber. And then the only other difference is coming out of the mile chute, we used to rise up and then drop down onto the track. It's a dead straight for the jockeys.
Paulie, there's people watching this right now and going, oh, this is a bit of me, January 27, I want to be at the Karaka Million, I want to be at Ellerslie, and I want to go. They want to book their flights, they want to book their hotel, they want to book a table at Couvée, they want to get involved. First things first, for those who want to book a flight and want to come to Ellerslie, how certain are you and your track experts the TRB Karaka Millions will be here?
Look, at this stage, very confident. Once we've had those first horses go off, we'll flick the switch. Everything will be on sale. So
mid-November?
We'll let people know.
Let's talk about the day slash night, because it could be one of the great iconic moments in Auckland racing, in fact in New Zealand racing. What does a relaunch of, I know there's a soft relaunch, which is 13 days before, so that's a functional race meeting. What does the relaunch Karaka Millions look like for you? What bells and whistles can Ellerslie bring to the party for? It's a pretty significant day.
I'd say it'd be probably one of my more stressful race days that I'm ever going to be at. So it'll be like a normal race day, right? Yes, the crowds will be big. We know that. Well, we want them to be big. But it'll be what people expect normally from coming to Ellerslie. So we'll be turning it on and hopefully we get a beautiful day like this.
Casual Friday for Paul Wilcox and Mike Gear, and we saw you out of the jacket, Michael. I won't delay
I wasn't
with
supposed
those
to
details.
Be on camera.
I won't delay. Yeah. Tell us those updates. Ellerslie, Avondale, Te Aroha.
Okay, Ellerslie, by the way, the grass was cut really short there because they're making it thicken up. It looks fantastic. It looks like carpet. I know it's a cliche. I'll be staggered if they're not there Karaka Million night. And that's what everybody wants and everybody's looking forward to. So those protocols will run through November. We'll have cameras there to keep you updated. No news out of Avondale, who aren't very good at communicating. Te Aroha is great. Had trials there recently. Everybody's in love with what's going on. Very positive reports. And they race Wednesday week. So Te Aroha is back. Welcome back. Thank you to everybody who's worked really hard at getting it done. Good news segment there, because Ellerslie as close as back and Te Aroha is back, and I think it's really positive for everybody involved. They looked at the Rotorua track after the half abandonment last week. They are happy that it won't be an issue heading forward. So, Em, a good news segment to end our day.
Yeah, we'll leave on that positive note. It's been a pleasure to have your company on Way In this morning. We'll be back same time, same place next week.